Hello, YouTube. I am the Sony TC106A 7-inch reel-to-reel monophonic tape recorder. I date from approximately 1968 or 69. I am a vintage machine, and I was dead. But ClydeSight got a hold of me and made me live once more. Let me tell you about my features. I have several of them you will find very interesting. I have a volume and a tone control, which is running an 8-watt amplifier, solid state. I have a 3-digit tape counter. I have an optional recording system. You can record on me manually working the meter, or you can put me into auto mode and Sony-matic recording will guarantee a perfect recording every time. I have 3 speeds. Currently, I am talking to you at my slowest speed, 1 7/8 inches per second, to show you how good my quality is. But I can also run at 3 3/4 and 7.5 inches per second. My function control features rewind, stop, play, pause, and fast forward. I have a beautiful wooden case with plastic accents. And I have a wonderful cloth front speaker grill. ClydeSight is going to show you how he took me from a dead machine and brought me completely back to life. This box is supposed to contain a Sony TC106A tape recorder that is in need of some work. Okay, I've got the flaps off. This has full flaps all the way around. It's kind of interesting how they made this box, and we've got it opened up and we can see the inside. And as often happens, the thing is packed with a lot of styrofoam and no bubble wrap this time, but the tape recorder is wrapped up in plastic and well protected by the styrofoam. And here it is. So the next step is to get this thing out of the box. So here we see the lid, and we can see there's quite a few scratch marks on it. This is expected. And we see the speaker grill. Seems to be in good shape. It's a nice cloth. It says Sony-matic. The badge is there. It's not damaged in any way. Okay, here we can see the nice wooden side here. It looks better on the camera than it actually does in real life. Here's the input and outputs. There's no cracks or anything here. Back looks to be in pretty good shape. Here are the mounting screws. A little bit of a ding here. On the final side, which is here's the feet, the rubber feet, and they're in good shape. And this is a storage compartment. We'll take a look at that in a minute. We can see the grill for the fan for the motor. It's all solid. It's all connected. Some scuff marks and so on. The badges are all here, the UL badge is here. So it looks to be in pretty good shape. Let's take a look at the rubber feet. They're rubbery, that's nice. They're not loose, that's good. So far it looks like the machine is just, it's dirty and cosmetically it needs some help. Nothing unusual with that. Okay, the compartment has 2 tabs on it. And when we lift the compartment door open, we see a power cord, and that's all of that. Okay, this is a pretty heavy-duty power cord. It's a 3-prong, as you can see here, but if we look at the cord itself, it's two conductor. Now, you know, with these old machines, you really have to check absolutely everything and do it very closely. Something happened to this this spade on the plug. I'm not sure what it is that happened or why they did this. It looks like it's been deliberately ground for some reason. Not sure what is going on there. And it's also discolored here pretty much and chipped up. It might have got caught in something. you know, or squeezed with some kind of a tool. It's very hard to know what's happened to these things. People do the strangest things with their tape recorders, but it's structurally, it's very solid and very sound, so I don't think it's going to be much of a problem. I'm going to lift the lid, and it just comes off. And of course, looking in the lid, we see very, very typical of these old tape recorders. They always like to make these spongy, round pads in the lids, which sit on top of the reel tables here, exposed to protect them. And these always deteriorate, so they always need to be replaced. And we can see the two tables. The tables are pretty solid, so they look pretty good. They're in good shape. Here's the speed selector. It's a three-speed machine. It's set to the middle speed right now, 3 3/4. So this all looks good. No cracks here. Here's the digital counter, the three-digit counter here. It's set to 951. I'm going to push the reset button, see if it goes to zero. And it did, so that means that this is functional. Here's the record switch. That's moving, but it's stiff. There's an auto or manual switch here. That seems to be working okay. Let's take a look over here. We have the control knob here. I just pulled it right off. The models that I've seen usually have a black band in here, and that seems to be missing. And I think it was a glue-on piece, because if we look right here, you can see a bit of glue residue. Something could be put in there, or it doesn't really, it doesn't bother the function of the machine, just the look of it. Let's see if the function control works. Okay, it goes into rewind, stop, play, pause, fast forward. Okay, all that seems to be working well. Here is the head cover. This head cover should probably lift right off. There we go. We've got the head cover. It's in good shape. I don't see any cracks or serious marks on it. It's just dirty. There's a bit of a ding right here. Here we see the pinch roller, the capstan, the heads, and the pressure pads. Now let me put it into play. And in play, it is not engaging. This should pop up, and so something is definitely stuck here. That mechanically should engage. There is an automatic cutoff switch here, and it is not being allowed to engage at all. See, it's not moving at all. So obviously something is definitely very stuck. So the next step is to get the top cover off and take a look at what is binding this. And so now we're ready to do the great reveal and lift this off. If it'll come off, it seems to be sticky. And now it is off. And this is very much like the TC-104. So we can see there's the main idler for the capstan. Here's the idler for the fast forward and take up. And here's the rewind idler and belt. And here, of course, is the table for that. So the next step is to find out just what's going on here. Now, in Sony machines, the capstan is always free to spin when the machine is put into the stop position. So we should be able to turn this capstan. And you hear that noise? That's not good. So I'm going to do some exploring in here and try and find out what is going on. The capstan can be lifted up quite a bit. What happens when I lift it and spin it? There's no noise. When I put it into play, I can turn the motor and it will turn the capstan. So it will engage the drive mechanism. But why this is not moving, Who knows? We'll find out. Okay, we've made another discovery, which is very interesting, and it has to do with this little switch here. I'm going to zoom in for this. This cutoff switch goes, it's a wire, and it goes back behind this post here, and then it comes over here, and this is the actual micro switch that works this. Now, when I put it in rewind, you notice that nothing happens. The brake does not disengage, this piece does not move, and it should be able to move. Now, I can see there's a trace bar here so that this is pulled by this brake over on the other side. So if I pull that brake, I can get it to actually move. And you can see now the trip is able to trip. But this is really sticky and stuck. Very common problem with Sony machines. It's a grease problem. The grease that they used in these machines turns to varnish. And so what I've got now is a machine that's not lubricated. It's kind of glued together. Not a problem to fix. You just got to get everything apart and start cleaning it. Wait a minute. Now, listen, ClydeSight, before you start explaining the mysteries of how I work, I want to talk to the people and tell them about another mystery they're going to enjoy just as much. It's a great book that you wrote, ClydeSight, called The Cross of Ramplett, The Mystery of Throckmorton Manor. Now that book is available on Amazon.com. It's available for Kindle. It's a great mystery book. So anybody who enjoys the mystery of tape recorders would enjoy the mystery that is presented in this book. It's light, it's humorous, it's fun, and it has some suspense in it. It's a terrific book, and it's available on Amazon.com for their Kindle reader. And if you don't have a Kindle, that's okay. Amazon will let you download a PC application to let you read a Kindle book on your computer. So there's no excuse for not getting the book. Go to Amazon.com, look for The Cross of Ramplett, The Mystery of Throckmorton Manor. You're going to enjoy it very much. And now, ClydeSight, you can explain the mystery that is me. All right, I have this little mechanism taken out now. Very hard to get it out. And if you look at the bottom of it here, I'm going to bring this up close. Keep it in focus if I can. You see all this white stuff? That's where it turned to glue. So what happened was this plate glued itself to the bottom here. That was supposed to be grease. It's not. So the solution for this is very simple. Just get a good cleanup using a little bit of WD-40 or some Marvel Mystery Oil, which is a cleaning oil, to get this varnish out of here. Clean the post, clean these parts here, and this should now run freely once that's done. But this is just one step in the whole process. This whole machine, all the grease parts have seized up because of the varnish. So I've got a lot of work to do to get this mechanism running. But I like doing this, so we'll see how it turns out. This is the feed table, and it had a belt that went to the digital counter, so I've removed that belt. It's going to have to be replaced anyway because it is loose. And I discovered that the table is held to the main deck by three screws and a plate. So I've removed those screws, and now I can lift this entire mechanism off. And I can see the construction of it. And you can see that it's held in place by an E-clip here, and then there's this spring mechanism and so on to give it proper back tension. And here is the actual, it's very shiny on the camera, but here is the actual piece. It just simply is going to need to be taken apart and cleaned. But now that it's out of the way, I have more space inside the machine here to do some very thorough cleaning, which it's just going to need. Grease is a serious problem here. This plate here is held by screws to the main deck, and so removing the four screws makes this able to come out. But there is a trick with that, and that is the control mechanism, which is here, which is located over on this side, just out of camera range, that's run by the function control. And this thing was totally covered with that sticky grease. I'm amazed it could even turn. Most of this deck has been cleaned, so what you're going to see is not the awful grease and gunk that's in it. You're going to see the thing now restored. I'm going to hold the capstan shaft and turn this thing over. And now we can see the bottom of the whole unit. And this, of course, is obviously the capstan flywheel. Now, you remember that the capstan was grinding when it was turning? And that's because it was pressing against this little flange here that holds down one of the transfer arms. The reason it was doing that is because right here was a problem. And I'll take out the capstan to show you. Now, looking on the side, we can see that the capstan is actually made of two pieces. It's the steel capstan shaft, and I assume that this is bronze flywheel. Now, you see here the end of the capstan shaft is a point, and that's what it's supposed to be. When I took this out originally, this point was all the way up inside the bronze flywheel. Somehow this whole thing had shifted. And how that is possible, I don't know, because this is a very strong pressure fit. But that was what was happening. So as a result, the whole flywheel was sitting lower. In fact, it was hardly able to clear the bottom of the deck. So as a result, the flywheel was rubbing against this piece here. This is the back plate for the capstan flywheel. It rests on this. It's made out of some special material with the capstan just basically sitting on that and the point not there. The flywheel was rubbing against this. So what I had to do is just simply bang very, very carefully using a rubber mallet the capstan shaft so that it is now clearing. And to show you how this works, here's a ruler. And you can see now there's plenty of space, whereas before it was like this, a very little space. So now there's plenty of space for it to work properly. And this has to be aligned just perfectly because of something else that happens. Now notice that the inside of the capstan is hollow. Okay, now we'll put the capstan down and we'll show you why that is hollow. Here we are looking at the underside where the capstan goes in. And this arm here, and you can see I'm pointing to the roller, which is here, that goes against the control shaft here. This arm travels on this hinge here. This is an axle, across here and over to here to control the record play switch interlock. And there's a spring here, so it has to be free. You see now it's free and it's able to work. Now this does two things. First, it controls the pinch roller position, and we can see the pinch roller shaft is right here. But the second thing it controls is this rotating plate, and this rotating plate is what makes the pinch roller go up and down. As you can see, it has a ramp on it, and that ramp is pressing this shaft. This is the shaft for the pinch roller, and it's on a spring here, and it's riding on this ramp. Now watch what happens as I move this. So as it moves back, it lowers and pulls the pinch roller away from the capstan and down. And then as it is released, it lets it go up. Let me do this again slowly. That's kind of a jerky way to make it work, but you can see the principle of it. And at the same point, it works these pressure pad shields. So now watch the pressure pad shields here. See how that's working? So all of this here sits inside the capstan flywheel here. That's why this shaft and its position is very, very critical to the machine working properly. Now, what had caused this all to stick was that the axle here for the plate was, of course, filled with that varnish grease, as was the axle for the transfer plate that holds the capstan pinch roller. So I got all this stuff out, totally cleaned it up, and this is ready to be reassembled now. With this assembly all taken care of, I can move it out of the way carefully because the heads are still there, and I can start addressing this side of the unit. And here's an example of a really bad greasing situation. This is the control mechanism that moves the main drive idler out of the way in stop, and what happens is that that keeps the idler from getting flats on it. And it's controlled by a tab right here on the main control lever. There's quite a bit of grease here, so this all has to get cleaned. And there's some similar grease problems here. Any place where there's moving parts that's going around a hinge point, what's basically a hinge point, this all has to come apart and the grease has to be taken out and cleaned. And of course here is the take-up table, and that's going to have to be taken apart and cleaned also. Well, you can see that I've done the cleanup in this area here, and I've replaced it with white lithium grease and a combination of that and this thing called Marvel Mystery Oil. Now, I have an injector, and you can see the red oil inside it. Marvel Mystery Oil has been around for a very long time, since the 1920s. It is a cleaning oil as well as an engine lubricant. It's a really nice oil, and it's a thin oil, so it works in very tight spaces, which is very, very nice. And let's take a look at some of the features here. Now, here is the control cam. And it's a double cam. There's a cam here and a cam up here. And you can see one of the travel arms is right here. And this brass spins on this axle and rides against the cam. That all has to be greased. I haven't done the greasing yet. There's another one here. This works the brake system. You can see how the spring holds it against the cam. And then there's a locking cam in the back here, which you can see right here. And this locking cam is what keeps the cam thing in its proper position. Now, you see there are other parts of the cam here. There's a post right here. That post and the other parts work with these mechanisms here. There's a little lever here. You can see that's moving a little bit. There's this lever here, and there's this lever here. And this all works different parts of the machine. So what I have to do is force these into the open position so I can get the cam, which goes through this little hole, back into position. We also have the capstan ready to go. They put this ring of felt around here. And I think that what they're trying to do is deal with a problem that comes when you have a hollow capstan especially. Listen to this. So I guess you could call a tape recorder a musical instrument because it rings like a bell. Now the felt is to try and stop the ringing, but it's not very effective. The machine is now all completely cleaned and lubed and back together, and the entire mechanism is ready to go mechanically. Now, why did I have to do all this mechanical work before I could even test the machine electrically? Well, if it's not working mechanically, it's impossible to tell what's going on electrically. So we'll be looking at the electrical system in a minute before I power the thing up. So far, I have yet to power it up. But here is the actual mechanism with all of the rubber parts cleaned and the capstan is cleaned. Now, remember how the capstan was grinding? Now listen to this. You can't hear a sound. And when I lift it up, you can hear that jiggly. There's always a little bit of space. No grinding at all. One of the ways you can test these machines to see if you've got your mechanicals all put together right is to actually run it without power by engaging it. So I'm going to put it in rewind. Now in rewind, the idler wheel for the drive is out of the way. This drum here is pressing up against the rewind table, and there's a belt here that goes around the motor. If all the pieces are tight, I should be able to turn this and see the motor turn. And there we go. Can you see that? The motor is turning as a result of my turning the turntable. Let's see what happens when we go into forward. Now in forward, the pinch roller has come up against the capstan, which it was not doing before, and I can test it with my finger. It's pretty tight. The drive idler has gone between the motor and the capstan flywheel, and this is in the 3 3/4 position, which is the middle step on the motor pulley. And at the same time, this idler has gone between the same step on the motor pulley and the lower part of the friction clutch mechanism for the take-up. Now, if everything works right, I should be able to move the capstan by turning this assembly. And you can see that the capstan is turning. Now we put it into pause, and we see that the pinch roller is engaged, disengaged, and the brake is on both here, the take-up table, and the rewind table. And so then we go into fast forward. Now in fast forward, this idler is lifted by a little tiny elevator here, so it's up on the second level here. As I turn this, it turns the system. So we know that we've got good mechanical contact. The next step is to take a look at the underside at the electronics to make sure that there's nothing busted there or there are any loose connections, and then I can power it up and give it a try. To look at the underside, we have to take off all 4 feet, and then this piece comes right out. Here we see the motor with its fan. The top part of the motor is lubricated through a tube. That's why these injector oilers are so useful. So let's take a look here. We see a very large power capacitor, and that seems to be okay. I don't see any problems with it. It's not dented. It hasn't shown any signs of expanding, which would be a danger. Here we see the speaker, obviously, some power transistors, some more capacitors. I'm looking and all of it looks pretty good. I don't see anything that would look like a damaged capacitor or damaged component. And that's really important because if there was a damaged component in here, I don't want to power this thing up. There's no cracks in the board. It doesn't show any burn marks. This is a record play switch here, and it's completely sealed, so it should be okay. And of course, here's the jack board. It looks to be in good enough shape that I think I can give it a power on test and see how it works. Okay, you've been following along with this restoration, and this is exactly how I'm doing it. So I've not tested this machine yet. I have no idea if it'll work or not. In order to play safe, I'm using a 5-inch set of reels here. I've got them threaded up, and I'm going to plug in the machine and give it a shot and see what happens. Okay, so the first step is to plug in the power cord. So far, so good. Nothing has exploded. Now I'm going to turn on the volume control. And I see the pilot light came on, and I can see the motor is running. And it seems to be pretty quiet, the motor. So the next step is hold your breath, take a shot, turn it on. Tone control works. Okay, so obviously it's electrically functioning. Now, let's see if fast forward works. There's pause. Okay, the fast forward is obviously working quite well. Pause. Play. And there's the stop. Okay, maybe needs a little bit of adjustment there. There's the rewind. All right, let's see how it does in 1 7/8. Yeah, there's definitely, I got to make some adjustments to the brakes. See how that's, it's slipping forward. Let's try 7.5. All right. I like that the best. Okay. So I need to make some brake adjustments, but machine is obviously working. I have the TC106 pretty much adjusted and ready to go, and there have been some changes from when you last saw the video. First thing you'll notice, which is very apparent, is this red felt that's lining the capstan. I got that idea from looking at his TC104 by Sony, where they had a similar problem with the ringing of the capstan. The capstan flywheel is so well cast, it acts like a bell. And the purpose of the felt is to dampen the ringing. Now, I looked in the TC104. They had done the same thing because they had a similar problem with it. So now, there's less ringing. No matter how smooth this idler wheel is, it does have some rumbling effect against the capstan flywheel. That makes it ring a little bit like a bell. And that gets picked up by the microphone when you're making microphone recordings. The other thing I did was I changed the brake pads here. Originally they were a black cork, but they just simply were so worn out that the reels were spinning on the brakes, and that was causing the problem that we saw earlier where the machine was not stopping correctly. This comes forward. When it comes forward, this switch is opened, and that cuts off the power to the motor. The amplifier still contains power, though. So when the tape is in the machine, it pushes the lever back, closing the micro switch, and thus allowing power to go to the motor. And so that's how the auto cutoff switch works. eBay people who sell these machines and don't know anything about tape recorders often are confused because they won't put reels on the machine, and they'll turn it on and then put the function control into play or rewind, and it will temporarily move, but that's about it. And they think that there's something wrong with the machine. Watch what happens when I put it in rewind. It starts up and then it stops because the cutoff comes all the way forward to here. Now, pretending that this is a piece of tape, if I push it all the way back, the way the tape would do it, you can see that it allows the machine to run. The first test we're going to do is using a microphone. This is a Sony F98 cardioid microphone. It's already plugged in. I've set this to automatic recording, and we're going to test it at the 3 speeds, 7.5, which it is now, 3 3/4 and 1 7/8 for a voice recording, and then we're going to use a little MP3 player to put some sine wave tones on the tape, as well as some music to test it. Now, why is the reel set up this way, with the full reel here and the almost empty reel here? That's because this is the hardest test the machine will ever have to face, because the mechanical advantage is not working for it here. Notice that the capstan has got to pull the tape from a very small diameter hub area, whereas here it's a large diameter. Now, if the tape was flipped over, the situation would be the opposite. And it's easier to pull it off a big reel than to pull it off a small reel. So if there's going to be wow and flutter because of any kind of mechanical drag, it's going to show up here, but it wouldn't show up if you were recording at the beginning of the tape. So this is a very good test. To do this, all I have to do is put it into record and then turn it on. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is a test of the Sony TC106A reel-to-reel tape recorder. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 at 7.5. Switch to 3 3/4. So I have to turn it off, change the speed, then I can record again. Now, I'm going to disconnect my microphone, and I'll connect my MP3 player into the auxiliary input. And this is a 3 kilohertz tone, which is what Sony uses on their cassette tapes for testing their cassette tapes for wow and flutter. Now for this I'm going to put it into manual record so I can watch the meter and adjust it. So the first step, since we're at 1 7/8, let's just leave it there. Put it into record and pause. Now I can, with the speaker monitor switch turned on, I can turn on the MP3 player. Now it's on. All right, so I got a good reading here, and so I'm ready to record. And now we want to hear some music, because a sine wave is a very hard test on a tape recorder, and music doesn't come out in pure sine waves. It's fun to watch the tape work, so with the cover off the machine, so let's watch it rewind. It's very quiet, and of course the tape is tracking properly between the reel flanges, otherwise you'd hear jiggling. Okay, so now we're ready to play back, and here we go at 7.5. Testing 1 2 3 4 5. Testing 1 2 3 4 5. This is a test of the Sony TC106A reel-to-reel tape recorder. 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10 at 7.5. Switch to 3 3/4. Now we're at 3 3/4. Testing 1 2 3 4 5. Testing 1 2 3 4 5. This is a test of the Sony TC106A reel-to-reel tape recorder at 3 3/4. 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10. This is the end of the test. Testing 1 2 3 4 5. Testing 1 2 3 4 5. This is a test of the Sony TC106A at 1 7/8. 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10. This is the end of the voice test.
Okay, now we're going to hear the tone test. Here comes the music.
Right now we have to change over to 3 3/4. Alright, now we're going to go to 7.5 and hear that. Okay, so what's the analysis here? Well, the sine wave is a very, very difficult test for any tape recorder. It's a very difficult test even for an MP3 player, even for a computer. They don't like doing it. It's because the tone is so absolutely pure, and you can hear how it's going to distort.
But music is much more varied and much more flexible. So what you hear is distortion in the tone. You won't hear necessarily as distortion in the actual music. So as far as I'm concerned, listening to the music on this at all three speeds, this is still a very, very fine tape recorder from the 1960s. And it is playing correctly, and you're not hearing any really bad wow and flutter. We're just hearing some small variations, which you would expect from a consumer-grade tape recorder.
Thank you for watching the video about me, the Sony TC106-A monophonic tape recorder from the late 1960s. I hope you enjoyed watching the video and discovering all the mysteries about how I work. And don't forget, if you like mysteries, go over to Amazon.com and pick up your Kindle copy of The Cross of Ramplett, The Mystery of Throckmorton Manor. Oh wait, are you saying you don't have a Kindle? That's okay. Amazon will give you a free Kindle reader for your PC or Mac. Just look for it on the Amazon.com website. So you can read the book whether you have a Kindle or not. You're going to really like the book. If you like mysteries like I was a mystery, you're going to love that book. It's tremendous fun. Doesn't have any tape recorders in it, but it's got some pretty girls. Enjoy the book and keep watching ClydeSight for more vintage tape recorder videos. Bye-bye, YouTube.